Praise the Lord. I tell you, Friday night was a good night for me, and the Lord was pretty good to me Friday night. I want to start off with a testimony. I've been kind of secretly wanting the iPad Mini with the LTE for a while, and I thought about getting one through my cellular company that I have. And I decided to call them Friday night, see if they had any Black Friday specials. So I called him, and he said, "Well, we got a special. You get that." I called him about the if they had any Black Friday specials on the iPhone 7. And he said, "Well," he ended up saying that they have one that where you can get buy an iPhone 7 and get an iPad free. And I can just give you this iPad free without the, just go ahead and just send that to you." And he said, "Let me talk to my boss." And they come back and he said, "Yeah, we're going to do that. We're going to send you a free iPad." And he said, "Well, I'm going to upgrade, go ahead and upgrade the RAM, the storage to 32, because he said, "You don't want a 16 gig storage." He upgraded that to 32.
Praise God.
And sending it free. I don't have to activate it, he said, if I don't want to. Just keep the iPad, and there's no 2 year with it. And but I'll probably put data on it. But I mean, free shipping and free iPad Mini.
All right.
And it's a decent processor. So so I can preach. I have them side by side, have my notes and have the scriptures, and not have to go back and forth. And it's lighter to carry. And I might use it in my daily readings at night because it's lighter. It hurts your hands less holding it up for a while. And that's $400 the Lord provided for me for free.
Amen.
It's got cellular.
Amen.
And I want to praise the Lord for that. And it just worked for me. I told Greg about it, and Greg called, and they said they had to pay for, in order to get one, they'd have to pretty much sign a contract. And so the Lord worked it out for me. He knew I wanted one, and I really needed one, and because it is smaller, and I can have it side by side for my notes. And look at my notes and look at the scriptures and not have to go back and forth on the apps. You know, I can just look over. So,
amen.
I just want to praise the Lord for that. That's a $400 gift that God gave me Friday night. And I was pretty excited. I didn't want to say much. I was kind of mouthing the dad, see if he could read my lips, because I didn't want to say it out loud. I didn't want to ruin that gift. And I checked, and it's coming to me.
Praise God.
I checked the order status, so.
Amen.
I want to praise the Lord for that.
Amen.
And that's God there. $400 gift. I said, "Abby," I called the boss at work, and she was working, and she didn't have the same carrier, but she was happy. I said, "Well, I just got so happy I wanted to call somebody." And she's a Christian too, and I was just really excited about that. And I want to praise the Lord for that.
Amen.
And God worked that out. And the book is out, available to purchase. And this is the final cover. This isn't the final book print. We found some mistakes I needed to fix, you know, spelling and different things. But this is the final cover. The book is out. And you can purchase it on Amazon too. Or go through to purchase it through CreateSpace, and you just go to youridentitybook.com. That's easy to remember. I created that, Lord that provided that for me too, that URL. I got it for 99 cents, so and it goes to this, easy to remember. Go to youridentitybook.com, and you can turn around and get to the back.
Yeah, that's good.
Here's the back. And that's the final back of it. And I want to praise the Lord for that, because he actually guided me to someone that can put it in the Kindle format, which that's quite hard, because I can't do that myself. And I got a pretty good deal on that. And I think he's going to help me with my next book, doing the editing and stuff like that, sort of save me a lot of stress. But it's out, and I'm going to probably try to mail some to India. I don't know when, but I'd like to do it soon. But we'll just see how that works out, because I think it'll change them. I like that the message is, that's a foundational message for pretty much all the teachings that I do and preaching. That is a foundational, and it'll be foundational for all the books that are the Christian books that I write and stuff. That's a foundational teaching. And some people, I have preached on it, not in depth like that, though. And it's 244 total pages, and but it's a foundational teaching. And it's about who we are in Christ and our identity and what Jesus done for us on the cross. And I go into my personal testimony, and I just thought that was important to have that in there to show how that teaching touched me and changed me. And I didn't go into everything that's happened in my life. It would be three big volumes, I'm sure. But I went into some things that happened. And just kind of for people to see, really grasp that message. And the testimony is powerful. That's the greatest, really, the greatest thing that we can share is our testimony. And that's power. You read that in Revelations. And that's a prophecy. Testimony is. And it's very powerful, the testimony. And Jesus said that many times. He talked about going sharing how they got healed. And there was a lepers. They actually, one of them, only one came back. And so testimony is very powerful. And praising, that's praising the Lord. So, glory, hallelujah. Ooh, I feel the Lord. And but I just wanted to share that. It's a very foundational teaching. I encourage you, if you can, to get it. Or contact me on the church site if you want bigger quantities. But there's actually available. It'll probably be available through Barnes and Noble in different places. You can ask them your identity. And Chan Smith, the author. And you should be able to get it through there, too. And there's also a way you can get it by bulk sales. I can find that information if you want it. And it's available worldwide and Kindle worldwide, and to be fully formatted soon. I just wanted to share that. But it was a good night Friday night. That will become available too. And God's good.
All the time.
Amen.
Amen.
And the next one, I'm not going to go into too detail with it, but it will be on the Holy Spirit. And what I preached about, and I think that's a good secondary book. And then go into the kingdom and stuff. I want to have these books. I want them to have to be to change the culture of an area and change the culture of the world to kingdom-minded culture. And I think it's very important. And I lost these songs here now. I hit the wrong button. And glory, hallelujah. And we're going to write a ministry manual, I think, too. And maybe me and two other, I know maybe me and Greg, but maybe another pastor that I know, too. And I think it's just a way to change people. And you can really get into a book more than just sitting listening, and or listen and read it at the same time. So I just want to praise the Lord for that. And the first book I wrote was on the typewriter that Mary Jane bought me. So this is the first printed, but that's not the first book, technically. And Mary Jane had a big part of my life. And she encouraged me to do that stuff. So,
amen.
She's up in heaven, but I know that she's excited about this. I know she is. And she bought the typewriter, like a brand new electric typewriter, took me to Walmart in Madison and bought me one. I remember that. And I never did get it. I wish I had it. I would probably get it published now, but I don't think I have it. But that was actually the first one, and I don't know how old I was, 12, 13 maybe, I don't know. I couldn't drive, so I could have been 15, but I don't think so. I know I couldn't drive then, and I drove when I was 16, so and she drove me over there. So I praise the Lord for that. Not, me sharing about my testimonies, but anybody else have a testimony to share? Be a good time for this Thanksgiving we just had. And I know I always try back in the day and have go to a good old Pentecostal church and people stand up giving their testimonies. I just stood up and shared. I want to thank the Lord for saving my soul and making me born again and changing my life. And some people make fun of that kind of thing, testimony, but that's the most powerful testimony you can give.
Amen.
In my opinion.
Amen.
And so everybody's got a testimony to share. And pray for Steve. He said he's got real bad cancer, guy at work. And he went in for back trouble. And he's got lesions all over his spine of cancer. And it might have broke one of his vertebrae. And he got it in the colon maybe and stuff. So pray for him. Just pray that he'll get born again. And the Lord put it on my heart. I was reading something, I think it was on the news thing, or somebody posted it or something, on Reuters, that Kanye West was in the hospital, and they actually said this on the secular Reuters, is a secular news site, that he was having a spiritual crisis, and that's actually what they said. And that's unusual to put on a secular media thing. And but the Lord told me to pray for him, and why I mention that, I think we all need to pray for him, because I think maybe he could be on the verge of really having a great awakening for the Lord, and the Lord touching him. And if he does get born again, completely have the people that he can reach is millions and millions and millions, and we all know that his family needs to get reached, who he married into. We all, you know, his family, and so that'd be a great. I just pray for him, because the Lord can use that spiritual crisis as a way to reach you. And so I just felt led to bring that up, and I just think he could have reached many souls. It's about reaching souls anyway.
Amen.
And so let's pray for that. Invite the Holy Spirit to come in and pray for Greg. And Lord, I ask you to touch Steve, and we speak a healing in the name of Jesus. We speak to that cancer leave right now on Steve in the name of Jesus. You know his last name. I speak to healing in the name of Jesus. I speak to the cancer leave right now in the name of Jesus. Lord, I ask you to your Holy Spirit to follow him. Holy Spirit, you're welcome in the name of Jesus, and to touch him. And if he's in the hospital right now, Holy Spirit, you touch him in the mighty name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. And just get him, touch his heart so he can get born again. In the name of Jesus, let him be born again. In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, glory, hallelujah. In the name of Jesus, glory, hallelujah. And we speak to Kanye West, Lord, that he'll get born again, God, and you'll touch him in this spiritual crisis he's going through and healing. And we speak a healing into his body, and we speak to the devil loose him in the mighty name of Jesus, and we speak to the devil loose Steve in the mighty name of Jesus. And Lord, we ask you that you'll touch Kanye West in a powerful way. He'll get born again, God. He'll be a great witness for you, God, in the name of Jesus, because we are to be a witness. And that's our calling, all of us Christians, all of us followers of Jesus. Our calling is to be a witness.
Thank
not
you.
To witness, but to be a witness, Lord. And I ask you, God, that he'll get born again, and he'll have a encounter with you, and he'll be a mighty witness for you, God, in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
And that whole family that he married into will get born again, God, and now just get their life right with you, and their light will shine, Lord, and if all of them will get born again, it'll be one of a great catalyst for a huge, great, a worldwide awakening, I feel, Lord. So touch them, Lord, in the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus. And rebuke the devil off of them in the name of Jesus.
Yes.
In the name of Jesus.
Hallelujah.
In the name of Jesus. We ask you, Holy Spirit, you'll come into this place. Holy Spirit, you'll welcome into this place,
yes,
in the name of Jesus.
Hallelujah.
In the name of Jesus.
Thank you,
Holy
Jesus.
Spirit, come in the name of Jesus. Amen.
You are welcome in this place.
Glory, hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord.
Glory, hallelujah. I also do want to share that on my book, I didn't put it on your website or anything like it, because it's not about me. And I just intentionally didn't put all that stuff in there, just about a good teaching. And because it's not about me, and I just felt like to mention that. And because we kind of get, sometimes we have bad motives. And it's about Him, amen?
Amen.
Glory, hallelujah. And come forward to, we do this older song first, and then go into some other ones.
Savior. And darkness tries to hide, and and trembles at his voice, and trembles at his voice. How great is our
so highly exalted, Lord.
see my sin upon
a wretch like
Thank you, Jesus.
Glory, hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Y'all want to find out one, or is that?
That's good.
Okay, we'll get into it. Preaching. We're going to mail double the Bibles this time to India.
Same Hallelujah. Way. Good deal.
Amen.
Amen.
And I'm excited about that because, you know, they're hungry for the Word, and they're hungry. They're just hungry people. They're hungry for the Lord. And that's really why I want to mail these copies of what I wrote there, because they're just hungry for everything that they can just get a hold of. And you know what?
Amen.
And if I had a church out there, I could probably fill the biggest stadium every week.
Yeah.
They're hungry.
Amen.
And probably within a few days, if I went there, I could probably, I'm not saying this to brag on me, I'm saying how hungry they are. And I think if I went there within 2-3 days, I could probably fill the biggest stadium you got there, biggest stadiums here. And I'm not saying this about me, I'm saying this how hungry they are. And I'm not saying this because I'm anything special. They're just hungry people. And I was telling somebody that the other day, and it just blesses me, and they're polite. And I've worked with several throughout my long time in my current job, and they're just I've never had any problems with some but people from India. They're just the nicest, politest, most respectful people, and they're respectful for a clergy. Members, highly respectful for clergy members.
Amen.
And they're just really good people. And I tell you, but it probably, if it wasn't for no one to reach in them, it would be hard for me just to, you know, I'm sure the Lord, Lord has encouraged me through all you all, and I'm not saying that, but they are a great encouragement to me to stay in the ministry knowing that they're getting blessed and knowing that we're reaching them because, They're really great people, you know, and I do see things, I don't know how much they're going to improve, but I think they will improve in India, and of course when you get the gospel in there, when especially when people are that hungry for the gospel, they can't help but get better.
Amen.
When you get people that hungry for the word like they are, it's a powerful thing when somebody's hungry for the Lord. And that's a catalyst for revival right there, when you're hungry for the Lord. And it wouldn't surprise me if it didn't start over there before it really started anywhere else. Because I'm telling you, I think probably, besides Brazil, one of the hungriest people in the world, in my opinion. And of course, they are in Africa too, and I'm not saying that. They're hungry in Africa, and there's some hungry, of course, in the Middle East. But in Brazil and India, they're the hungriest people that I know of, because I'm telling you, they'll fill big areas, big stadiums. And like in Brazil, they got, Randy's working with this one church that started out like 200 people when he went there. Now it's like at least 30,000 or more, the church is, and in Brazil. And that's something to think about. I mean, our biggest church here in America is will fail to how big churches are there, and they're hungry for the Lord, and that's something to think about. And people, a high percentage of them are getting healed, see, they grab hold of something when you tell them. They'll grab it and they'll keep it.
They'll go with it.
And I go with it.
Amen.
And he preached this. I've never been there, so I can just have to share testimonies of others that's been there. I steal the testimony. That's okay. And they said that one service, he said, now wave when you get healed. And he then he shared a word of knowledge, and they would wave. And he said, "Now, I think y'all misunderstanding me." Translate for them again, the translator. He said that you wave when you're healed. So he would give words of knowledge, and they wave their hands. He said, "I think they're misunderstanding. Share with them, wave when they're healed. Not, you know, not before, but when they're healed, wave. When you're healed, not that you have that, but that you're healed." And they shared it again, and he said, and they waved, you know. He said, "I don't think they're understanding." And the translator said, "I don't think you're understanding."
Amen.
He said, "They're healed." And they preached down there. Another person preached before him was sharing that when somebody gives a word of knowledge, that's like Jesus standing right in front of you and pointing to you and saying, "You're healed."
Glory.
And they receive that as such. In America, we don't receive that like that.
No.
In Brazil, and this, where this was, he said they received that like that. It was when that word of knowledge came, and that word of knowledge, they had that issue that they saw it as Jesus himself physically standing in front of them and, you know, pointing at them, saying, "You're healed," and laying hands on them, saying, "You're healed."
Amen.
And they got healed instantly through words of knowledge.
Praise God.
And that's the highest percentage of he's seen of people getting healed was down there. And a huge high percentage of just people just all over the place getting healed. I mean, thousands getting healed. And and that's something to think about.
Glory.
And we need that here. And I'm called to the church in America, and I know that. And where your calling is at, usually you reach the hardest opposition. But I'm also called, also am called to the Muslims too in different areas of the world. So I do feel that. And so I'm not running down America, as I love this country very much, but there is some things that we could definitely improve in the church, and that's one of them is receiving, just having faith and grabbing a hold of something. We're just hard to grab hold of things, I guess. I don't know why, but it's, you know, it's powerful. Word of knowledge is powerful, and the testimony is powerful. And when you give a testimony, that's prophesying that you can get healed. And that's powerful. We've lost the power of the testimony. There's several things we've lost, the testimony and the impartation. We've lost that. We've lost the impartation for as a whole and readiness to receive what God has for us. And that's a very big, important thing. And like we've lost the impartation, Paul said he laid hands on Timothy and he stirred up a gift within him. And that's very important in the early church. Before someone got into the ministry, the people that was over them would lay hands on them and pray for them, prophesy over them, and impart into them the gifts that they had and stir up the gifts inside of them and encourage them. But, you know, it seems like people think that just because the Lord touched them that they don't need that. You still need that. The Lord definitely touched them in the Acts days, in the Bible days, but they still had the impartation. That's what God sets it up. He sets his church up that way. Why? Well, God doesn't want confusion in church.
Nope.
Confusion is bad. Confusion is the opposite of Jesus. It's the opposite of God. He wants things to be done right. And I'm not saying people can't do things for the Lord, but still, we need to, there's some things that we still need to grasp. You know, because obviously if you get a big church of 30,000, then, you know, a little confusion can completely destroy that church. And you just can't have that. You got to have things to work right. When the Lord shows up, he shows up to a church that is ready. You know, and I know they don't get a lot of amens on that, but that's true. You got to have people trained, and they have to. You receive a prophet in the name of a prophet, you shall receive a prophet's reward. You need to respect and honor leadership and people that he has in ministry. Honor them. You don't worship them, but you honor that gift. And when you honor that gift in someone, you can get and get that impartation from them.
Amen.
You see, and it's very important. And I've always said this, and I'll say this until I die, that it's just as important. I'm not saying ministers are, you know, people are God, but it's just as important to get man's blessing as it is God's blessing. It's just as important. If you don't believe me, read in the Old Testament. I'm telling you. Samuel appointed kings. Yes, God could have come up and pointed at Saul, but he didn't. He used Samuel. Right?
Amen.
God could have come down and pointed at David and burned the bush and said, "You're king and go be the next king." But how did he do it? He went through Samuel. It's also a verse in the Bible, this is like my teaching, but it says God doesn't do anything unless he first reveals it through his prophets. That's a verse in the Bible. So we do need to get that in the church. And because, you know, I'm for God moving, but when you see these places that God is moving, they won't let anybody pray unless they went through the ministry, prayer training and stuff like that. Because you just don't know what's going to come in. You just can't let someone come on off the street. You don't know if they're in witchcraft or whatever. And it's very important. And I just felt led to go into that. Somebody might need to hear that overseas. But it's very important, you know. It's a balance. There's freedom, but they still need. I've learned that the hard way. So praise the Lord for that. Everybody receive that. That's some extra. I'm gonna charge you for that. That's extra. Going to Luke now. I've been preaching out of Luke, and this goes into John the Baptizer. And the Baptist Church doesn't get their start from John, you know, contrary to popular opinion. Some people might think that John the Baptist started the Baptist Church. That's not really true. Or Jesus started the churches. And at least the real churches. And Baptist Church, actually, I think, got their start in a series of revivals. I can't remember where they was at, but the Lord really showed up powerfully. But John the Baptizer, as he was called the Baptizer, John the Baptist, because he baptized people in water. Whether you believe in immersion or sprinkling, all, you know, that's neither here nor there. I personally believe in immersion. But, I don't know if you'd go to hell if you just got sprinkled. Because the blood of Jesus is what saves you, not that water anyway.
Amen.
You know, I think we make issues out of things that God does not make issues out of. It's a Pharisee spirit, I think is what that is. Or some religious spirit. I'm reading out of Passion Translation. John the Baptizer, that's Luke 3. A powerful message from God came to John, Zechariah's son, when he was living out in the lonely wilderness. This prophetic commission came to John during the 15th year of the reign of Emperor Tiberius, son of Caesar. Pontius Pilate was governor over Judea at that time. Antipas, son of Herod, was governor over Galilee. Herod's brother, Philip, was over the region of Tyre, or whatever, and I'm not going to read these words, another one, and Lysania was over Albany, I'm not going to get into specifics on those because I don't know how you pronounce it. This happened during the days of two high priests, Annas and Caiaphas. See, there was two high priests. One of them was actually a legitimate one, and one of them wasn't a real legitimate. one. It's a little story into that. You know, one of them, it was really appointed by God, and the other one was just appointed by man through political reasons and things. Supposed to be one high priest. When John went preaching and baptizing throughout the Jordan Valley, he persuaded people to turn away from their sins and turn to God for the freedom of forgiveness. You know, and we need that today, somebody to do that. And you know, we get worried about titles, but you know, they didn't call him John the Evangelist or Evangelist John. They said John the Baptizer because he baptized people. You know, and I think the big hindrance today from doing this, from going out and just persuading people, is we kind of falsely preach in the church that that's just the evangelist's job. We preach that this evangelist does this. But let me tell you something. Everybody that's a follower of Jesus is called to do this. This is not the evangelist's job. This is all of the followers of Jesus. And I think we're too much worried about titles instead of just going out and doing stuff for the Lord. And if you want to preach, go out there in the street corner. Persuade people. Amen. Nothing better than that. This was to fulfill what was written in the book of the prophet Isaiah. Listen, you will hear a thunderous voice in the lonely wilderness telling you to wake up and get your heart ready for the coming of the Lord Jehovah. Every twisted thing in your lives must be made straight. Every dark way must be brought to the light, wrongs righted, injustices removed. Every heart of pride will be humbled low before you. Every deception will be exposed and replaced by the truth, so that everyone everywhere will be ready to see the life of God. He was a forerunner. John kept preaching to the many crowds who came out to be baptized. You know, that's something to think about. Many crowds came out to be baptized. So what's our excuse now? Their society was... We think our society is bad, but you know, the Roman Empire, Roman society was a rough society. And you know, maybe it's a problem we're not rough enough, I guess. Maybe that's the case, I don't know. But they came out, this many crowds came out to be baptized by one man preaching. That's enough right there to preach, close the service right there, almost couldn't. One man preaching brought out many crowds, and one man paved the way for the Messiah. One man preaching. And how many people is thousands and thousands probably at one time getting baptized? Because Jesus, how many crowd did he have? You think about that. For one man preaching without a sound system, without a church building. So what's our excuse? We got a church buildings. And you are nothing but the offspring of poisonous snakes full of deception. Have you been warned to repent before the coming wrath of God? Then turn away from your sins. Turn to God and prove it by a changed life. Don't think for a moment that it's enough to simply be a favored descendant of Abraham. That's not enough to save you. I'm telling you, God couldn't make more sons of Abraham out of stones if he chose to. That's what he preached. Even now, God's axe of judgment is poised to chop down your barren tree right down to its roots. Every tree that does not produce good fruit will be leveled and thrown into the fire. Now that's straightforward preaching, ain't
it? Amen.
Get thrown out, Bobby, if you preach this now. That's straightforward preaching. Now he was... That's good preaching. the crowd kept asking him, what then are we supposed to do? But see, he gave them a solution. He just didn't preach it without a solution. That would be crazy. God will give you, he's the solution giver, isn't he?
Amen.
John then told them, give food to the hungry, clothe the poor, and bless the needy. Even the despised tax collectors came to John to be baptized, and they asked him, what are we to do to prove our hearts have changed? Be honest, he replied. Don't demand more taxes than you want, than what you are required to collect. See, everybody came, and us, asked some soldiers, what about us? See, everybody came to him. The despised tax collectors came to him, and he talked to them, he gave them solutions. That's what the church is called to do. We can read what John the Baptist did and get out of that what we're called to do. You want the Great Commission? It's right there. Soldiers came. Jesus answered them, be content with what you earn. Never extort money or terrify others by threats of violence or be guilty of accusing the innocent. During those days, everyone was gripped with messianic expectations, believing the Messiah could come at any moment, and many began to wonder if John might be the Christ. And so everybody was gripped with expectation. Now, you know, expectation is a powerful thing. If you read about Azusa, there was an expectation in the air in Azusa, because a lot of different various things came together at that time to the turn of the 1900 came in. And there was an expectation in the air. And let me tell you, expectation is a great thing. Expectation in our hearts. That's a powerful thing.
Amen.
And the church needs to be an expectation of God showing up again.
That's right.
I have an expectation there and a hunger there. And if you want to see the God show up, there has to be an expectation. Amen.
Amen.
For the God to do something. You look in Acts 1, that God came. Even in the book, the first of Acts, in Acts 2, Acts 1 and 2, there was an expectation. They was gathered in an upper room expecting, and there was a core group. There was a larger group, and I can't remember the number. There was a much larger group. Some of them left and got discouraged. Oh, it ain't going to happen. You know how, you know, we wanted our timing. We want it now.
Yep.
Like, one, like we drive through in at a drive through a fast food place. That God is in his time. And it's about that being persistent and having an expectation and not losing that. Just keep, even though it might seem like it's not going to happen, you keep having that expectation. You don't lose that. You keep having that expectation. You have that, you be persistent. Everybody that's persistent will always succeed in the kingdom of God. Everyone in the kingdom of God, if you're a follower of Jesus, you will succeed if you be persistent and have an expectation. And you read other times that God showed up in Acts, and there was an expectation of him coming down. There was an expectation. In Moses, there was an expectation that people knew that when he walked into that tent, that God's glory cloud would come down, and it came down. And Moses knew that it was going to come down because he was a friend of God, and he spoke to God face to face. There was an expectation in Moses' heart that he knew that when he called upon God, that God would be there, and he would talk to him, physically talk to God. And God came down. There was an expectation there in Moses. He knew. That's a faith. That's a gift of faith.
Amen.
There's an you read back in Miss Wigglesworth, there was an expectation there. He knew that they would get healed. There's an expectation there. And people usually they have a gift of towards a certain thing of faith, towards a healing, or sometimes toward a certain area of expectation, or they can have a broad range. Or some people can have a gift of faith or expectation of getting souls saved. But I believe you should have this God movement in general, all of it. You know, have that expectation and don't lose that. Keep hold of that. Smith Wigglesworth contended for God for a while before he got a hold of it. John Wimber contended for God and kept praying for people, but he didn't lose that faith. You can go Lester Sumrall contended in the place where he went to, but he didn't lose faith in God, showed up and he changed that nation. And to this day, their nation is a Christian nation because of Lester Sumrall. Let me tell you something, that's that expectation of faith of just not giving up. You don't give up, and it don't matter how hard it seems, you keep contending for that. In this area, they had that expectation for the Messiah. And guess what? What happened? There was that expectation. And it might not be exactly the way you want it or where you picture your mind. But let me tell you something. If you be open to God and just have that expectation, He'll come down. It might not be the way you want it, but it'll be the way that's right. The Pharisees, they had that expectation, but you know what? They didn't see what had happened. They wouldn't accept it. They didn't want to. Jesus reprimanded them. We can get into that Palm Summit here in Luke. Jesus reprimanded them because they wouldn't discern the signs of the times. What's that mean? They didn't know what God was doing right then. They had the expectation, but they didn't see that it was happening. See, there's two parts to that. Having an expectation and being persistent, having a faith, and having it to know when God is doing it. When Amen. God answered that.
Yeah.
Receiving it when God does it. That's another issue we have in the church. We don't receive it when God is doing it. We just want to have the expectation, but we don't want to see when He does it. We want something else, I think, and it doesn't come in the package that we want. And our picture nicely wrapped package. So we're like a bunch of spoiled kids. I don't want that. And we give it back to Him. I'm just going to preach honest with you. We like a spoiled kid sometimes. But when God finally gives it to us, it's not exactly what we want. But we ask for it. So we throw our fit to God. And we don't receive it. And we lose our blessing. Because we don't receive the gift. I know that's pretty straightforward, but amen that. Amen.
Yep.
We got to receive it when He gives it to us. It might not be what we want, exactly wanting, but it's what we need. God uses people that's not who people want, but who He wants. That's who He wants to use. You look at these world changers throughout history. These people wasn't very, you know, they might have had temper issues and different other issues. It wasn't what people chose, it was who God chose. And you know what? If they don't receive you, Jesus said you dust the dust off your feet and go on to the next one. I know that's hard preaching, but it's in the Bible. You've got to preach the whole thing. I assure you, there's room for the gift, the call that's on your life. God will do that. He'll make room for it. He'll set you out there where you're supposed to be. And you don't do it yourself. He'll make room for you.
Jesus didn't want to go to that cross. That's what God had for him.
You know, the disciples tried to talk him out of it. That's not what they wanted. But you know, God knew what was the best. Yeah. They was looking for a warrior. But they got a lamb. But guess what? That lamb was more powerful than any warrior. Because that lamb did more than no warrior could have done what that lamb did.
Amen.
See, it's what we need. And we need to accept when God shows up. You know, there's many times when God showed up. Exactly what people was looking for. But when you grab a hold of it, this one minister was... There was some revival that happened. I study revival. It was a big revival that we all know of, but I can't remember which one it was. and this great evangelist that we all know of, it changed the world. At first he didn't receive, but this other evangelist that changed the world, he didn't receive it, what was going on in his meetings, because that wasn't what he was expecting. It's not what he wanted. Because people, this was back in the history of the church, and we've all heard of this person. I can't remember their names right now. I have to read the book to get a refresher on the names. He didn't like it because people were going into trances, and teenagers were going in, teenage girl was going into trance, and God was showing up in the powerful ways. But this other man didn't like it because it wasn't in his package. But guess what happened? This other man, God starts showing up in this other man's services. Well, he said, well, God, you do whatever you want.
Amen.
Then that other man become a world changer. It wasn't in his package that he wanted. See? And that I can preach on that for 3-4 hours. Receive it receive it. I always say when I'm praying for people, you got to go into receiving mode. There's a time to receive. We miss that in the church. We don't preach that. There's a time to receive it. That's why when I pray for people, I'm just going to throw this out there and get upset all you want. I very seldom see anyone get healed that's praying when I pray for them. There's a time to receive. Because Peter said, told that person to get up and walk. So the guy got up and walked. There's a time to receive your healing. Then praise God for it.
Amen.
Amen?
Yep.
And that's verified by other people that God told me that a long time ago. And that's verified by other ministers to do the same thing. There's a time to let them pray over you. You let that person pray over and you receive it. And you'll get healed. I tell you, everybody that just receives it will get healed. So in verse 16, but John made it clear by telling them, there is one coming who is mightier than I. He is supreme. In fact, I'm not worthy of even being his slave. I can only baptize you in this river, but he will baptize you into the spirit of holiness and into his raging fire.
Amen.
Verse 17, he has in his hands a winnowing fork to clean up his threshing floor. He will separate the wheat from the chaff. The wheat he will gather into his barn, but he will burn the chaff in a fire that no one could ever put out.
Amen.
John used many similar warnings as he preached the good news and prepared the people. That's what he did.
Mm-hmm.
He prepared them. He even publicly rebuked Antipas, son of Herod, the governor of Galilee, for the many wicked things he had done. He fearlessly reprimanded him for seducing and marrying his sister-in-law, Herodias. Adding to his many other sins, Herod had John seized and locked up in prison. One day, Jesus came to be baptized along with all the others. As he was consumed with the spirit of prayer, the heavenly realm ripped open above him, and the Holy Spirit descended from heaven in the visible, tangible form of a dove and landed on him. Then God's audible voice was heard saying, my son, you are my beloved son. Through you I am fulfilled. And here's the thing, there was another thing here that, there was another account of this, it could be in John, that John said, I need to be baptized to you. And Jesus said, no, this is the way it's got to be done.
Yep.
And see, even Jesus realized the importance of impartation. And Jesus now, went to John the Baptist to get baptized. Now that's something to think about, isn't it? assumed to be Joseph's son, was about 30 years old when he began his ministry. Here are the names of Mary's ancestors from her father, traced all the way back to Adam. So these are Mary's descendants, his mother. Remember I told you there was a lineage for Joseph in the Bible, and there was also a lineage listing for Mary. This is Mary, so I'm not going to read this, but this is Mary's listing here. And that's all of chapter 3. And and I like this translation. They actually say that it's Mary's. It was common that people already knew this, but they never really shared a lot of translations whose it was. That's Mary's lineage right there. So what that would mean, what? What would that mean on that lineage? That's on Jesus' physical side. That's his lineage.
On both sides.
Yeah. Well, you know his father's side.
Spiritual side and spiritual.
Even his physical father's side also.
Yeah. Well, they had his physical father, Joseph, they had a lineage there too. They were saying that somehow that through traditions that Mary's father, trying to get this correct, and it kind of adopted Joseph or something, and it kind of being his father in tradition. I can't remember I heard somebody explain this, but I can't remember going to all that. I don't know. But we all know who his Jesus' father was.
Amen.
And so on his physical, through his blood lineage, it was, I don't want to say blood lineage, but physical lineage, there's that listing there. Glory, hallelujah. I think we go into chapter 4. We're going to go into chapter 4 here.
Amen.
Or close.
What the Lord tells you to do, brother.
I like to go on to chapter 4. See, Jesus was tested. And it was the verse of Jesus, every temptation known to man. He was tested and tried. So, we go through trials and temptation. But he was tested, the devil threw everything he could at him. I don't know if anybody, people would, I'm sure, would have a hard time saying no with some of these things that the devil offered Jesus. offered him all these things. You'd have a hard time saying no to all the kingdoms of the earth, wouldn't you? Just be honest with yourself. Could you just say no without thinking about it? He was tried and tested.
Yep.
Food and different. Let's go into this. From the moment of his baptism, Jesus was overflowing with the Holy Spirit. See, after his baptism, he was taken by the Spirit from the Jordan River into the lonely wilderness of Judea to experience the ordeal of testing by the accuser for 40 days. The devil was known mostly as an accuser. In the book of, was it Job? He was an accuser. He accused Job. He was an accuser. And that's really the devil. And he's an accuser of the brethren. That's the most, what the devil was actually known by as an accuser. And that's another free thing for you there. And so he was taken by the Spirit, so I'm kind of wondering if he was a translated, or if you walk there or what. That's an interesting thought there. But he was tested by the accuser, which is the devil, for 40 days. He ate no food during this time. See, that would be something there. That would be a huge thing for me to have to praise the Lord about afterwards. That would be a huge trial for me not to eat food for 40 days. And especially in the desert. And ended his 40-day fast very hungry. It was then the devil said to him, "If you are really the Son of God, command this stone to turn into a loaf of bread for you." Jesus replied, "I will not, for it is written in Scripture, life does not come only from eating bread, but from God. Life flows from every revelation from his mouth." So life flows from the revelations from God's mouth. The devil lifted Jesus high into the sky, and in a flash showed him all the kingdoms and regions of the world. The devil then said to Jesus, "All of this, with all its power, authority, and splendor, is mine to give to whomever I wish. Just do one thing and you will have it all. Simply bow down to worship me and it will be yours. You will possess everything." We all know that God raises up kings and he pulls them down. So the devil lied here. It wasn't his, he thought it was. That it wasn't. Jesus rebuked him, saying, "Satan, get behind me, for it is written in the Scriptures, only one is worthy of your adoration. You will worship before the Lord your God and love him supremely." Next, the devil took Jesus to Jerusalem and set him on the highest point of the temple and tempted him there, saying, "If you really are the Son of God, jump down in front of all the people. For it is written in the Scriptures, God has given his angels instructions to protect you from harm. For the hands of angels will hold you up and keep you from hurting even one foot on a stone." Jesus replied, "It is also written in the Scriptures, how dare you provoke the Lord your God?" That finished the devil's harassment for the time being, so he stood off at a distance, retreating until the time came to return and tempt Jesus again. So he tried to do everything he could, but, you know, it didn't work. Then Jesus, armed with the Holy Spirit's power, returned to Galilee, and his fame spread throughout the region. He taught in the meeting places, and they glorified him. So we know before Jesus' ministry, two things that happened. Right before it started his ministry, physical ministry, is he got an impartation. He went and got baptized with John the Baptist baptizing. Well, that's three things. He went and fasted, but then he got tempted. The devil come against him. So, you know, don't get upset when a lot of bad things happen to you, and it's not the end. That's only but the beginning. Amen?
Amen.
The devil is scared is what he is. He's trying to throw everything at you to get you to give up. But there's greater things have yet to happen. Amen?
Amen.
When he came to Nazareth, where he had been raised, he went into the meeting house, as he always did on the Sabbath day. When Jesus came to the front to read the Scriptures, they handed him the scroll of the prophet Isaiah. He unrolled the scroll and read it where it is written. And here's the thing here that's not taught, but there's some kind of Messiah chair or something that they have in the, they sit in the meeting houses that the Messiah would sit in, was made for to sit in that chair. It was a Messiah's chair. Was, I can't remember exactly what it was called. Messiah, and that's where Jesus sat on that. Did y'all know that? That's what happened during this right here. The Spirit of the Lord is upon, this is the Messiah's, this is what the Messiah would eat, this Messiah's edict or whatever you would call it, right here is what the Messiah would, this is Messiah's statement. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, and he has anointed me to be hope for the poor, freedom for the brokenhearted, and new eyes for the blind, and to preach to prisoners, you are set free. I have come to share the message of Jubilee, for the time of God's great acceptance has begun. After he read this, he rolled it up, rolled up the scroll, handed it back to the minister, and sat down. So he sat down. Everyone stared at Jesus, wondering what he was about to say. Then he added, these scriptures come true today in front of you. Everyone was impressed by how well Jesus spoke, in awe of the beautiful words of grace that came from his lips, but they were surprised at his presumption to speak as a prophet. So they said among themselves, who does he think he is? This is Joseph's son who grew up here in Nazareth. Jesus said to them, I suppose you'll quote me the proverb, doctor, go and heal yourself before you try to heal others. And you'll say, work the miracles here in your hometown that we heard you did in Capernaum. But let me tell you, no prophet is welcomed or honored in his own hometown. Isn't it true that here were many widows in the land of Israel during the days of the prophet Elijah, when he locked up the heavens for 3.5 years and brought a devastating famine over the land? But he wasn't sent to any of the widows living in that region. Instead, he was sent to a foreign place, to a widow in Zarephath of Sidon. Or have you not considered that the prophet Elisha healed only Naaman, the Syrian, rather than one of the many Jewish lepers living in the land? When everyone present heard those words, they erupted with furious rage. They mobbed Jesus and threw him out of the city, dragging him to the edge of the cliff on the hill on which the city had been built, ready to hurl him off. But he walked right through the crowd, leaving them all stunned. You know, people don't want to hear the truth, do they?
Nope.
They get upset. But you know, that wasn't on him, that was on them. That wasn't to Jesus' discredit, it was to theirs. Jesus said, dust off of your feet as a testimony against them and leave. So that's against them, not you. Jesus confronts a demonized man. Jesus went to Capernaum in Galilee and taught the people on the Sabbath day. His teaching stunned and dazed them, for he spoke with penetrating words that manifested great authority. In the congregation there was a demonized man who screamed out with a loud voice, "Hey you, go away and leave us alone. I know who you are. You're Jesus of Nazareth, God's Holy One. Why are you coming to meddle with us? Have you come to destroy us already?" Just then, the demon hurled the man down on the floor in front of them all, but Jesus rebuked the demon, "Be quiet and come out of him." And the demon came out of him without causing him any harm. Great astonishment swept over the people, and they said among themselves, "What kind of man is this who has such power and authority? With a mere word, he commands demons to come out and they obey him." The reports about Jesus spread like wildfire throughout every community in the surrounding regions. See, they'd have this ritual to do to cast out devils. And like there's some church denominations that have that rituals. But you know, Jesus had come out and that's all they needed to do. And they was astonished that he didn't have to do that, all that other rituals and this 2-hour ordeal, 3-hour ordeal, and you know, 12-hour ordeal, or a day ordeal, and going through all this ordeal, and where the person minister out, and all the people, you know, that's doing it, wear them out, and just this huge ordeal. And you know, you've heard of that even in modern times, people going through these huge ordeals. See, they was astonished at that. They couldn't. They were just like, "How? What?" They was astonished that he didn't have to even go through 5 minutes. He just said, "Get out," and they got out, and that astonished them. So I firmly believe that it should be easy for us to just cast that devil out. We shouldn't have to go through that long ordeal and wear you out over it. I mean, it might not always be the case that way now, but it should be. It should be the way it is. Because Jesus said what he did, that we can do that. We have that authority. He let us use his authority to do that. So we should be able to do that.
Amen.
I know people don't want to believe that. That's on you. You're just not reading the same Bible as I am, I guess. I'm reading the true Bible. Amen. After leaving the meeting that day, Jesus went into Simon's house, where Simon's mother-in-law was sick with a high fever. The disciples begged him to help her. Jesus stood over her and rebuked the fever, and she was healed instantly. Then she got up and began to serve them. See, if you want to know a model of how to do healing, when he stood over her, he just rebuked the fever. And then he just rebuked the devil. And just rebuked it. He commanded it with authority. That's what astonished him. He had authority. He commanded it. And she was healed instantly. Then she got up and began to serve them. That's a pretty quick turnaround there, wasn't it?
Amen.
She could have had the flu or whatever. At sunset, the people brought all those who were sick to Jesus to be healed. Jesus laid his hands on them one by one, and they were all healed of different ailments and sickness. They were all healed.
Amen.
He had a 100% success rate there. Anybody, you know, I don't know if I could say that. We've had a huge success rate here, but huge percentage, but I don't know if I can say 100. It should be, but it's not. It should be, though. It should be 100. He didn't say go heal some of them, did he? Demons also came out of many of them. The demons knew that Jesus was the anointed one, so they shouted while coming out, "You are the Messiah, the son of El Shaddai." But Jesus rebuked them and commanded them to be silent. He commanded them to just shut up and come out, basically. And they knew he was the anointed one. They knew who Paul was. There's an account of, in Acts, I believe, that these devils talked to this these one brothers that tried to use the name of Jesus, and they actually knew, the demons knew who Paul was. If you're anointed, you don't have to go, the anointing will make room for you. You don't have to go in and explain your credentials and what you've done. Well, I'm a pastor and I've done this and do that. Well, what does that mean? That's not going to heal anyone. The anointing is what does it. The anointing. The anointed one. They knew he was anointed one. See, that's different than credentials, isn't it? Amen.
Yep.
They knew he was the anointed one. Are you anointed? See, if you're anointed, the devil will know who you are, the demons. You don't have to go through that big ordeal. Just say, get out. They already know who you are.
Amen.
You don't have to say who you are. They know who you are. You don't have to ask their name either. I don't want to know. Jesus said, shut up. There's a teaching that you have to ask them and call them out by name. Jesus didn't want to have a conversation with them. He said, shut up. Be silent. So that goes out. I heard someone try to teach me that. You got to know the name of it before you cast it out. Well, what's it say right here? Jesus said, be silent, come out. He didn't ask him what his name was. He didn't try to talk. I don't want to talk to the devil. I don't want to talk to the demon. Do you? I don't. I just need to get out. I don't have anything to do with you.
Amen.
Do you?
Nope.
I don't. I don't need to talk to him. He ain't nothing. He's just a liar. So he, except he didn't lie about who Jesus was, but for the most part, he's a liar. He didn't lie on who. He said they were pretty straight on with what Jesus. You know, the devil know you're anointed before people do. He does something. Mm. The devil recognizes you're anointed before people will.
Oh yeah.
Figure that out. Demons recognized Jesus was anointed before the Pharisees did. That's pretty sad, isn't it?
Yeah.
Serious. That's a sermon in itself. At daybreak the next morning, the crowds came and searched everywhere for him, but Jesus had already left to go to a secluded place. It's good to have your private time. That's good to have your private time, be private with the Lord, pray, and so that's good. We still need that today.
Amen.
When they finally found him, they held him tightly, begging him to stay with them in Capernaum, but Jesus said, don't you know there are other places I must go to and offer them the hope found in the kingdom of God? It's about the kingdom of God. This is what I have been sent. This is what I have been sent to do. Jesus continued to travel and preach in the Jewish meeting places throughout the land. But you know, in order to give it out in public, you must have to receive it in the private. And to be a worshiper in public, you need to be a worshiper in private. Amen?
Amen.
So the Pharisees want to do things to be seen. Jesus taught them that. We must want to do it in the private. Amen?
Amen.
And it's about the kingdom of God. We have a king. I had someone really to speak against me because I preached about the kingdom of God, saying only Jesus can bring the kingdom of God. Well, he's the king, but he's gave us authority to bring the kingdom of God, right? Because we're part of that kingdom now, right?
Amen.
He's the king, but we serve him. So we serve him, and we're ambassadors to bring the kingdom of God. If you don't believe me, read about the pastor, the prophet, the teacher, the apostle. He said, the kingdom of God is at hand. You see, he told his disciples to say that. So if he was the only one that could, which he, we can't do it without him, but he's given us authority to go do it.
Yep.
That's just lazy talk of saying he's the only one who can do it. We get to sit around not doing nothing for the Lord. That's just a cop-out, all that is.
Amen.
Really. And we call it, bring it, bring the kingdom. Amen?
Amen.
I'm not saying you to establish in the millennium or all that. I'm not getting in all that. And you know, that's for somebody that's smart. All I know is what Jesus called me to do here and now is to go out, preach the gospel, bring the kingdom everywhere I go, and see people healed, see people set free, raise the dead. That's the commission, and that's all I know to do right now. Amen?
That's it.
We're called to bring the kingdom of God with us. And it talks about the word accuser and the devil are used interchangeably. Jesus' baptism and the 40 days of wilderness temptation that followed evoked parables with the historical narrative of the Hebrew Exodus through the Red Sea and the 40 years of the wilderness testing. 40 years of wilderness testing, Jesus was 40 days. Jesus refused to turn stones to bread, yet today he transforms the stony hearts of human beings and converts us into living bread to give to the nations. Jesus, the living word, is quoting from the written word. Deuteronomy 8:3, if the living word used the written word against the enemy's temptations, how much more do we need the revelation of what has been written so we can stand against all his snares. In chapter 4, verse 4, says it implies both the Greek and Aramaic text. Although this last clause is missing in some Greek manuscripts, it is implied and included in the Aramaic. Chapter 4, verse 5, implied for the Greek text simply says, took him up without telling us where. And 4:8, this is found in the majority of later manuscripts. 4:8, this is taken from Deuteronomy 6:13 and 10:20. And there's a lot of good stuff in Luke, and we miss out on that by not teaching and going through it. And that's why I wanted to go through that. I felt the Lord tell me to go through the book of Luke. And there's a lot of good stuff there that covers, of course, the Christmas story is in Luke. And Luke is very powerful. And like I said, that Luke is written for the church, not a person, but the church. That's what the Luke was written for. So we need to receive that. Luke was written for us today. Of course, the whole Bible was. But that's how Luke starts out, is written for the lovers of God. That's what that translates to. Theophilus is actually means there wasn't a person, Theophilus. It was the word means lover of God. So it's written to lover of God. Are you lover of God?
Amen.
So that's written for us. Amen.
Right.
And I'm excited about I've been learning a lot, and God is good, isn't he?
Amen.
And anybody need any prayer or anything, pray for our dad's stomach with that medicine. Lord, heal him in the name of Jesus. We speak healing in the name of Jesus. My dad's stomach, you speak healing. Charles Wayne's hand in the name of Jesus. Speak healing to mom's feet in the name of Jesus. Speak healing to my teeth in the name of Jesus. Amen. And I ask you, Lord, to come be with us, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Amen. Pray for me. I've got to go to the dentist to hopefully this, pray that this is a, my, make this one my dentist. I get sick of going to these different dentists. And pray that it's not $7,000 my cost like that other one was going to charge. I just let my teeth fall out.
I'll say you sat cheaper than that.
Yeah. So we'll pray about that, and I hope he's a good one. And if it's, you know, a local one, what I need done, I'll probably have to go back and forth several times according to what I hear. So it's a long time, so that's why I wanted, one reason why I wanted to stay with a local one. And hope everything goes correctly. And I want to praise the Lord for that. And that it will. I'm just something to pray. I want to praise him in advance. Amen.
Amen.
And,
pray for our country.
Yeah, Lord, I pray that you touch this country. I speak a peace over this land in the name of Jesus. I speak to that confusion to leave in the name of Jesus. I rebuke the confusion in this land, and I speak a peace in the name of Jesus. Holy Spirit, come into this land and bring peace in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Yes. Lord, let our light shine in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Glory, hallelujah, in the name of Jesus. Lord, let our light shine in the name of Jesus. And bring revival to this country in the name of Jesus. Let it be through me. Everybody say that. And let it be through me.
Hallelujah.
And let it be through me.
Praise you, Jesus.
Glory, hallelujah. And wherever you're at in the world, say, let it be through me for your country. Glory, hallelujah. We speak peace in the name of Jesus. Amen. And I remind you again about this awesome book. I don't know if it's conceited because I'm saying it or not. My mom helped me edit this so I can say it's awesome. Thank the Lord for her helping me. And this is a good message because it's the gospel message here. And it's about your identity, and it's the gospel message. And I love preaching this. I preached it so much that I just put it in book form, so maybe I won't have to preach it as much so y'all won't get bored of hearing all that. Just say, read the book. But it is an important message, and this is, like I said, this is a foundational message for the other teachings. This is the first message that God gave me when I got back into ministry. And it transformed me, and it'll transform you. It's your identity, being who you are. The title is Your Identity, subtitle, Being Who You Are, by author Chan Smith. If you're looking for it on the Amazon, ISBN number is pretty long for me to read out. Just go to youridentitybook.com as a quick way to, and it goes straight to the where you can order it. And here in a week, pray here, maybe in a week, the fully formatted Kindle version. And if you order it on Amazon for $2.99 more, you should be able to get the Kindle version of it. And I'm going to try to send a bunch of these to India because I know this message will transform them. And I'd like to eventually get it translated to in their language, but they'll grab hold of the basic message. And I like to do some video series on that and stuff to send over there. And I just want to praise the Lord for all of you all to back of me that has given me the encouragement to do that, because I need encouragement. And just happened to be the right timing. And I've got all y'all listed in there in the dedication. And, you know, Charles Wayne's been there from the beginning, too. So I want to thank him for being, you know, there. And Greg has, whether y'all know it or not, has been there. And He's the one that got me back in the church. Didn't know that, did you? Greg was. And my mom and dad have been a great encouragement, and I guarantee you this wouldn't be here. Of course, it obviously wasn't for them. But in other ways too, and my grandmother, I got born again at her house, long time ago, watching Pat Robinson 700 Club. He was preaching about cartoons and about the Smurfs, and I said, "Oh Lord, I like the Smurfs," and I got born again. I'm just telling you, I'm not preaching that it's wrong to watch that. I'm not saying that at all. I'm telling you, that's what God used to get me born again, was watching Pat Robinson. I believe it was on a Wednesday, so I went to church that night. I know I went to church Wednesday night, she said, "Well, you got to share this testimony." Grandmother did. So I went up there, and they prayed over me, and the whole church was there, and the Lord came down on me, and they prophesied over me, and I had so many prophecies given over me in the earlier times in my life, and I kind of want that still to happen, but it still don't happen like it did. Kind of had to pull that word out of them, maybe. But I did get a lot of prophecies at the beginning of my ministry. I didn't share all that in here, but I remember a prophecy that guest speaker came and called me forward, and he said that, and I do remember this, and I was young. He said that God's going to show you things, and it's going to be like you're looking through a window. It's going to be so clear. And this is the exact prophecy he told me word for word. He said, "But it will not be right now, because you're instantly backsliding and never go to church again because it's so powerful. But when in the future, that God will show you things, and it's like looking through a window." And that's exactly what he said. So I was probably, I don't know how old I was. Maybe 10, I don't know. When that word came, I was young. But that's, God has a plan for you. And whether somebody gives a word over you or not, it's not really here or there. I often say to people, "We'll give you words prophesying over you just because God knows you're going to need them if ever survive." It's going to be a lot of bad things happen to you, and you keep hold of that word. But often I hear that said, and I'm not against prophetic words. And I was going to share something else. Well, if God speaking to you directly is pretty powerful too. Giving you words. But I'm for impartation. Just because God does speak to you directly, you always need it confirmed. It's important to have something confirmed. It talks about 2 or 3 witnesses, let everything be established, get confirmation. Amen.
Amen.
And that's another sermon. Well, I'm going to close. And if you don't know the Lord, just repeat this after me. You don't have to repeat this after me, because if the Holy Spirit's on you, you'll know what to say. There's nothing wrong with the sinner's prayer at all, and I do it all the time. Speak it all the time with just say, "Dear Jesus, I need you to be in my, come and live inside of me, forgive me of my sins, and make me a new person." And you'll know what to say, and if it's genuine from your heart and the Lord, Holy Spirit's on you, you know what to say, and he'll come and make you a new person.
Amen.
And, you can get baptized in the Holy Spirit at that moment, or it can be separate. And the evidence is you're going to have power in your life, and you'll know and you'll feel it. So some people are baptized with the Holy Spirit when they're born again, because they know and they'll feel it in a great overwhelming presence. And some people aren't. You pray the Lord fills you anyway. And we kind of overwhelm, wrongly put emphasis on one gift, but I think we need all of them. Amen.
Amen.
And so that would be the evidence is all the gifts. No, the evidence is power. And and the fruits of the Spirit. I firmly believe that. And like Paul even himself preached it, said he believed in speaking in tongues, and he prayed in tongues more than everybody, but he wished that everybody prophesied. That's in the Bible, folks.
Yep.
Well, Charles Wayne, do you got something to share? I feel like you got something to share. You want to come up here and share something?
No.
Closing prayer?
I'm done.
I just feel like he's supposed to give something up here. Closing prayer or something.
He'll have to make it come out of my mouth. Lord, we thank you for this day, and we just give you praise and glory and honor, for you are worthy. Lord, we thank you for us being able to send your word out over the internet and Roku in the way that we do. We know there's thousands upon thousands that are receiving your word this way, even though we are a small group. But you're still blessing your word and making it come back, not void, but multiplying it many times over. We lift you up and give you praise and glory and honor, for you are worthy and worth it all.
Amen.
And we pray it in your Son's precious name, Jesus. Amen.
Amen. It says, open your mouth wide and he shall fill it, doesn't he?
Amen.
We didn't do offering time. Of course, you go to revivalshere.org if you want to give an offering. You can tithe through Tithely. If you want to have something go straight to the Bible Outreach, there's an option for that. If you've got the smartphone, you can do a bank account and a credit card through the Tithe LY app and search for Revivals Here Church, LaGrange, Kentucky, or you can donate online and to revivalshere.org. And I encourage you to do that. If you can, we keep sending Bibles overseas. And that's what we're reaching people. I just love seeing people get Bibles. That's my favorite thing. One of my favorite things, being in his presence, but something about handing the Bible out. I've hit and run is what they call it. It's what I do when I hand the Bible out. I just hand it to them and run off before they ask questions. I do. Hey, it works. They don't have time to say no. We just hand it to them and run. You're going to throw a Bible away, are they?
I'm serious.
You think I'm still kidding? Yeah, I have to. Glory, hallelujah. And well, here's an offering bucket here up front. If you got an offering here, and thank you, and happy holidays and Merry Christmas.